Okay, so this upcoming interview is freaking fantastic. Our audio video is a little bit of a pain just because she's in Saudi Arabia and I'm way over in Austin. But I asked her, I actually write a guest post to recap a lot of these pieces, and she's giving away a whole bunch of stuff with no opt-in required also, so that way you can get all this info. But still listen in because it is genius. So I just wanted to give you that. Make sure you check it out.
Potent advice and inspiration from real self-made millionaires. Welcome to The Eventual Millionaire with your host, Jaime Masters.
Welcome to Eventual Millionaire. I'm Jaime Masters, and today on the show, I'm really excited to have Bushra Azhar. She actually runs an amazing site called thepersuasionrevolution.com, and she says that it's a science, not an art, for persuasion. So I'm so excited to have her on. Thanks so much for coming on today.
Thank you so much for having me, Jaime. It's such a pleasure to be meeting over two different continents.
You are so happy and excited. I love that. So tell me a little bit more about why it is a science and not an art, because most people are like, I'm an introvert, I just can't do it.
Yeah, it's really interesting because I used to think for a really long time, I was born in a country, I come from a culture where if you're not a pretty little boy, then basically your chances in life are, you know, kind of not that great. So I was always good at getting a yes. And I always thought that I was inherently good at manipulating people.
I love that.
I thought maybe I was just a, you know, sneaky little bitch. So I actually knew how to manipulate people. But only recently, when I got into consulting and I was, you know, always good at getting a yes, going into a pitch presentation, locking million-dollar contracts, and I realized that actually there is a method to this madness and I can actually teach it. So I started training my associate consultants on the method and the process, and I saw people transform right in front of my eyes, becoming these Shark Tank participant style pitch skills. And that was like, you know what? It is totally a method to this madness. And that's why, because I've gone through this transition myself, it really is a science and not something that someone is inherently born with.
Okay, I adore this, especially since I have a 7-year-old little girl, and I'm like, she is, I'm trying not to say the word manipulative, I'm like a hardcore negotiator, right? Like I'm trying to reframe it because she's got that innately maybe from someone I know, you know? But if somebody feels like they're not good at it, sometimes they resist it. So what I would love to do in this interview is really start going through what is that process that someone can listen to this and feel way more confident to go about it. So you tell me, what's sort of step one?
So really, I think the step one is to understand that persuasion, the way I define it, and I think the way we should see it is, it's not something that one person does to the other person. Persuasion instead is something that a person does to herself in response to the stimulus that you expose her to. And really, your control is what you expose, what stimuli do you expose her to. You can't crawl inside her brain. I wish I could, but you can't crawl inside her brain and make her nod her head and say yes, right? What you can do is expose her to the right stimuli. And if you know what that right stimulus is, not only is a yes painless and non-icky, it's also actually kind of fun. So really, I think the very first thing is to understand that it's not something that you do to the other person. It's something that a person does to herself. And then one of the things that I did when I was in consulting, I developed something called the mass persuasion method. I used to call it the client persuasion method, but now in an online context, I call it the mass persuasion method. And really the idea behind mass persuasion method is to treat a human brain like an electric circuit. And if you really want to spark attention and approval from that electric circuit, you need to switch on certain switches. And really, it all boils, it's very, very scientific. It all boils down to kind of clicking those 8 persuasion switches. And once you've done that, you know, the yes is automatic.
Okay, I love this. I love methods to things like this. And I also love that you made the distinction between ickiness, because that's the thing. I feel like if you get them to, like, let's say you have like a little thing and you make them say yes, later they're just going to say no. Be like, oh, never mind. I really didn't mean to say yes. And that's not what we want either. That's a pain. You're like, yeah, I got the sale. Oh, wait, never mind. They want their money. right? So tell us, how do we go through those eight switches? What are they?
So really the first switch, which I think is really, really, really important in an online context, is what I like to call the relatability switch. And I think most people online, when they show up, actually not even online, I think most people, when they show up in an interaction with another person, we think that we need to have this premium positioning, and we need to look perfect, and everything needs to be spick and span. But the reality is that in psychology, there is something called the propinquity effect, which means that people like people who are like them. And relatability switch is all about being relatable, where I can look at you and think, oh my God, she's just like me. And that really, that one small element changes everything. Most people online, they're like, oh my God, I am sipping an expensive champagne on a yacht. And you know, there are all these pictures of them looking all expensive and rich. But that's not relatable to the person you're trying to sell to, right? So really the very first thing is to appear in a more relatable manner. Even if your brand is premium, do make sure that you share some of your struggles, some of your human elements, so people can actually relate to who you are. And, you know, that's the foundation for everything, really.
So I love that, especially because at the very beginning, I feel like you did this. You're like, what a great blue shirt and necklace. And I'm like, you're wearing a blue shirt and necklace too, right? So I'm like, oh, we're the same, even though, of course, it's a blue shirt. But still, to me, it was so, it definitely helped break the ice because we've never actually met like this beforehand. So I love that one, especially because we do think that we're supposed to be like super cool when we meet someone. All right, so a quick question on these eight. Do they have to go like in order, like an actual energy? Okay, good. So it's not like do the first one, check, do the next one. Okay, what's the next one?
Absolutely, they don't. But the interesting thing about these are that there are certain conversations. Like if you're closing a $1 million contract, you need to make sure you hit all eight switches. But if you're only showing up on media, for example, or you're sending a pitch to someone to interview you for your podcast, such as you probably need to hit maybe just two or three switches and don't have to go through the whole, you know, the whole mass persuasion manipulation of your kind of alien invasion of Jaime's brain.
We don't have to do that. Phew, no pressure.
So yeah, but again, relatability switch, I think it's not just about what you say, it's also about how you show up, what symbols you carry through in your message. So for example, when it comes to my brand, I would never show up like this because my people would be like, what happened to you? Who took over your body? It's like, this is a lot of makeup. You're wearing a necklace? Are you sure? So there are certain things that I do also because I'm really lazy and I would rather sleep in than do anything. But also because I want to appear relatable to my people. I don't want to appear too perfect because, again, there is something called the pretfall effect in psychology, which is all about the fact that human beings like others who are less than perfect. So when you appear less than perfect, not only is it more charming and endearing, it's also relatable. It makes you relatable. So basically, that's the first switch. The second switch is what I like to call the believability switch, where your job is to convince your potential buyer or your potential client to believe you and your product, which everyone talks about, right? You need to convince them to believe you and your product. But there is one other more nefarious angle that most people don't talk about, which is you need to also convince them in their own ability to get the results. And that's a very subtle thing, but we used to see that a lot in corporate, and I see that also in online business, where they believe you, they believe your product, they're absolutely sold to you and your product, but they think to themselves, you know, I am such a loser, I would never be able to get those results, right? And when that angle of believability is missing, you could have the absolute best product in the world, but they will not be able to buy it because they don't believe in their own ability, right? So so that's basically the second angle, the believability switch, the second switch.
That makes so much sense, especially with testimonials. Some people are like, well, of course that guy can do it because he's amazing, but I couldn't. And then they don't buy. And people are like, but I had so many testimonials.
Yes, yes. Perfect. And it's really interesting because there's a very easy way to switch on the believe, that angle, the believability switch. And that's using these two words. The words are even if. That's it. So, for example, if when I release Mass Persuasion Method, a course that I have, I said, yes, you can write high converting, super persuasive copy. That's a statement, right? They look at that statement and they think, yeah, but you don't know what a sucky writer I am, right? That's what they're thinking.
That's what I would say. Yep.
I include a statement at the end that says, yes, you can write high converting, super persuasive copy, even if you can barely write a grocery list, right? That these two words are what make them believe in their own ability to get those results. And a lot of people don't worry about that. They just worry about making them believe them and their product, but also make them believe themselves.
Okay, I adore this too. All right, what's three?
Okay, three is, okay, there are two switches that I don't like to talk about anymore because online businesses are kind of killing those. They're overdoing it. And one of those is curiosity switch, and the other one is urgency switch, right? So we all know that curiosity gets people to pay attention, right? But a lot of people are just doing it in a way where it makes you want to reach in through your computer, grab them by the throat and twist their neck because
clickbait. Yeah, no kidding. I'm like, come on, guys. Yes, I agree. Yeah.
And the same goes for urgency. So we all know that curiosity works. We all know that urgency works. But unfortunately, because people have started using it in a very unethical way, it's come to a point where I won't say it stopped working. It still works, but it creates a negative goodwill, right? You lose your goodwill when you use clickbait. So two switches that I don't like to emphasize a lot on now, even though there is psychological proof, there is scientific proof that they work. One is curiosity, the other one is urgency. But we need to be really careful about using it because, as usual, marketeers spoil everything, and they've spoiled it for us. But yeah, that's a fact of life. So the fifth switch is the desirability switch. And the desirability switch is all about, we all know that you need to paint a picture of a better future with your product, right? But there's one extra element to it. So yes, they need to be able to desire it in a way. When you describe your product or your service or whatever you're selling, they need to be able to see it in their mind's eye and feel it. So it's not just about saying, oh, imagine, I was just talking about this. I was recording a training and I was saying this. So you don't just say, imagine waking up in the morning and grabbing a cup of coffee. Instead, you need to say, imagine waking up in the morning, your warm feet stepping on the cold floor, curling up on the sofa with a warm cup of coffee, and then savoring the sweet, bitter flavor of the coffee as it goes. So you paint a picture with such visceral phrases that the person can actually see herself living that. And I think that really is what desirability switch is all about. It's not just saying, imagine making a lot of money. It's about saying, imagine fanning yourself with $100 bills, right? So it is a very, it sounds so, so icky, but that's what desirability is all about. Paint a picture where they can see themselves inside that picture doing those things that you're describing.
Okay, I have a question on this because I get that, and you see the best marketers doing some of this. Where is that line when you're in person? Because you know, you'd be like, okay, close your eyes. Imagine yourself in bed. You're like, okay, wait, never mind. That's not good for a sales call. Yeah. So where is that line? Because I totally understand when you're working with copy and that way, we're trying to get them to feel it. But how do we do that same thing, that switch in person?
Such a beautiful question. And I have the perfect story for this. So when I was in consulting, I live and work in Saudi Arabia. And I don't know whether you know this, but there are gold mines in Saudi Arabia too. So we had the opportunity to pitch to a company that basically had, they basically owned all the mines, including aluminium and gold and all of that. So it was a really big project, and we were pitching against really big consulting companies. And one of the things that we did to activate the desirability switch is that we actually created as a part of the pitch. Now, we are pitching as consultants. We are not an advertising agency. And we are pitching as a corporate social responsibility consultants, right? We are talking about how their social community programs can help the company. So we go in for the pitch, and we go in with an actual promo video of their community program. So we custom created a video of their community programs, press releases. The company is called Maden, with a Maden logo, newscasters announcing what great work they're doing in the community. And we played that video. And yes, needless to say, we won that contract, because you're not just saying, close your eyes and imagine. You're saying, you know what, if you work with us, if you let us craft your community programs, this is what happens. And you play the video and they're like, oh my God.
That's times 10 what probably anyone else did. You actually brought the deliverable thing to them directly.
Maybe the McKinsey's of the world, and we were pitching against McKinsey. So maybe the McKinsey's of the world would be like, oh, we're never going to do this. That's too dramatic. But yeah, it is. Maybe it is a bit dramatic, but it got us the contract. And it really makes people live that. So the CEO can see himself sitting down for an interview with a regional television talking about his programs, which is a big deal.
Now you can fan yourself with gold, right? That doesn't work as well, though.
The wings of the fan are all made of gold.
So now anyone that's going to pitch you is going to get a gold fan and fan you, just so you know. All right, so what's number six?
Okay, yeah, I need to remember what number six is. When you ask number six, I was like, do I have my notes? I mean, which one is number six?
Seriously.
Okay. So we talked about desirability switch. We talked about a believability switch. We talked about urgency, curiosity. Seriously?
Okay, see, people used to do this to me. They'd ask me specific things in chapters in my book, and I'd be like, oh, crap. So we can go to 7 or 8.
Because I'm really sorry. I will need to look that up. Oh, shit. I can't believe I did this.
That's awesome. Oh, my God. I'm actually really, really glad that you did that. Huh, see, it makes you way more relatable. All right, then do you remember 7 or 8? Because we'll just go over those.
Okay, it makes me look like I have placenta brain. I need to tell you about placenta brain.
Okay.
Placenta brain. I have a theory that once she gives birth and she passes the placenta, with the placenta, she passes a part of her brain. So, yeah. So I have 2 children, which means that I have lost quite a bit of my brain.
Me too. Yeah. Wait, how old are your kids?
8 and 10. But honestly, really? I'm serious. It's the placenta brain. It's not me. I promise. It's not me.
See, okay. I had the best memory ever, right? Like literally can remember birthdays from my second grade class. And I had children, and I am horrible. I don't know what it is. I'm so glad that I'm not alone.
Placenta brain. That's the placenta brain.
Okay. Good to know. I can blame it on something else. I love it.
My gosh. I can't believe my ultimate guide to look for the switches. I can't believe that. God. I need to be ashamed of myself. Desirability. What the fuck? I'm sorry, I'm constantly cursing.
Don't be we will bleep you, just so you know. I'm Googling it.
Yeah. Are you recording?
So I can help you. Yes, I'm still recording.
Okay, yeah. Oh yeah, please. Okay.
I'm sure you have a blog post on it, so I'm Googling it also.
Okay. Yeah, no, don't Google it.
Wait, that's
Google
persuasion.
I got it.
Trying to help you out here. All right, ready? I love this, by the way. Okay. You seem so relatable right now.
Okay, so we are at where are we?
6.
Where are we? I'm sorry. We are at, no, we're not at 6. Yes. Okay, got it. Yes. I wrote it. I promise. I did not pay someone on Fiverr to write this. I promise I wrote it myself. Okay, so the next one is the prestige switch. And the idea behind the prestige switch is that when we try to sell to someone, we think that we are selling to them a product or a service, right? And my favorite example of that is a lawnmower, right? So if you're selling a lawnmower, you think to yourself, I am going to talk about what a great high-powered battery-operated motor this lawnmower has. And that's basically the feature, right? So a lot of people focus on features. People who are a little bit smarter, they focus on benefits, right? So they would say, oh, it has a high capacity motor and it will give you a lush green lawn in 30 minutes, right? But here's the rub. people don't just buy the benefits. People buy things that elevate their social status. So really, when someone is buying that super expensive lawnmower, they're not just buying a lush green lawn. What they are essentially buying is the fact that that lush green lawn is going to make their fat, judgy neighbor feel like shit, because he's going to be like, oh my God, how rich are these people? So really, prestige is all about framing whatever you're selling, whatever you're trying to pitch, framing it in a way that, how does that thing elevate the social status of that person? How does that make them look a little bit better, make them look a little bit richer, or make them look a bit better amongst their peers? So, and that really, when I was in academia, and I used to help my students, I used to teach MBA, and I used to help my students write college essays for scholarships. One of the things that we would focus on was that, you know, when you talk about what great talent you have that you can offer that particular college, don't just talk about the fact that I have this talent and I can, you know, and I can help you. Instead, say it in this way: because I have this talent, that means your college, once they have me, they can win all of these debating competitions or all of these science competitions or whatever. So every offer that you have, try and frame it in a way that makes the other person feel like it'll elevate their social status, because we all want to be rich and beautiful and sexy and in the know, and we want people to tell us how great, rich and sexy we are. Yeah. Except us. If you come from my culture, you can't tell someone that they're rich, because that's considered extremely inappropriate.
Sexy is okay, but rich, no go.
Sexy,
they don't
okay.
Like my show for sure. So how do we do that though? Because the thing is, it's one thing to listen and go, okay, yeah, that makes sense. And it's, and a lot of people I know will go, okay, I understand the features and benefits, and we'll rework our product based on that. But when we try and start going, okay, now what is the mind of our client? What do they care about socially? How do we actually try to figure that out? Especially if it's not like, you'll look prettier, you know what I mean? One of the normal things.
I think whatever you are selling, there has to be, so I like to call it benefit beneath the benefit. There will always be a benefit beneath the benefit. And another example, for example, is a recipe book, right? So your recipe book allows a mom to create great, healthy, great meals in under 30 minutes, right? So that's the benefit. But then the benefit beneath the benefit, when you think about benefit beneath the benefit, try and see what is the prestige angle associated with it. So in this case, it's because all moms, universal, regardless of culture, struggle with mom guilt. And we want to be, we want that label of the best mom. We want to
super mom.
Super mom. Even if we say we're not super moms, we really want that validation, that label. That's our prestige switch. So if you can even tie that to a recipe book, and it may not seem like a direct connection, but you need to understand that for a mother, even though making a meal in 30 minutes seem like a benefit, really the benefit is so she can spend more time with her kids, do arts and crafts and all of those crappy activities that kids like to do and mess with your brain, and then be known as be seen as the super mom or the best mom or the cool mom or the great mom, or because that's our prestige switch.
So that is so perfect. I actually have a client who runs eatathomecooks.com, and she does meal plans. And we were going like, okay, where is it? So the benefits are easy to figure out, like your time savings or this savings or that savings. And then that's a really extremely valid point, because it's not as though you're delivering these meals to your friends where you're like, look how amazing. Because sometimes I make desserts and I'm like, look how amazing I am. Here you go. But it is like, wait, look how an amazing mom I am. And then I was able to, okay, that makes so much sense. I will send her this.
That's why Samsung now came out, and I say this a lot. So Samsung came out. It's really interesting. I'm a Samsung fan. So Samsung phone now came out with a picture with it's a specific food filter. And I was thinking to myself, why do we need a food filter? And again, it ties into prestige, right? If you're eating at a fancy restaurant and you have this fancy food plate in front of you, or you cook something that's really nice and fancy, you want to use that fancy filter, food filter, and then boast about it, right? Post it on social media. I just crushed some dates and nuts and made them into small balls. And I took a picture with my Samsung and I promise it looked like gourmet food.
So we are such attention seekers, right? We're like, no, wait, did you see what I did? Mom, look, did you see this? Yeah. You're right though. You're totally right. Awesome. So let's go to 7 and 8 because I want to make sure we have enough time to talk about your business because I'm so intrigued by that also.
Okay. So 7, parity switch. And parity switch is all about showing the other person why you are the best option amongst all options, right? And I know there are a lot of people who'd be like, oh, I don't believe in competition and there is no competition. And, you know, there's enough for everyone. And I get it. But the reality is your potential buyer, your prospect, is doing a comparison in her head. If you don't address the differences between you and your other alternatives, they're going to do the comparison in their head. And when they do the comparison in their head, they may not arrive at the conclusion that you want them to arrive at, right? So support them in doing the comparison. Support them, allow them to do the comparison. And even if you think you're not competing against anyone, which is something that I hear, I'm not competing against anyone, you're still competing against a no, right? You're still competing against a no. That person has the option to say no. So do that comparison. If that means putting up a table, which I did on one of my recent programs, I actually had a table on my sales page that said, this is what my program is. This is what all the other programs are. Like, really address it right. And because people are thinking it. So why not enable them to make that comparison on their, you know.
How do we do that? Because in checklist form, it's easy. But how do we do that without sounding negative about our competition? I remember my mentor would be like, never say anything bad about your competition. Like, oh, those people suck. So you'd have to sort of frame it like that's a choice also. But how can we we really sort of show that we're better without, you know, being mean about it?
Yeah, I think we don't need to. I love this question because I hear this all the time. And I know you're going to beep it, but I am a complete and utter bitch. So I really do not care. If I see something that's really sleazy, I'm going to call you out on it. So that doesn't apply to me, but there are nicer people out there. So for those nice people, the way I position it is you're not pointing fingers to the person. You're drawing comparison to the method, to the process. So I would always draw comparison between strategies and outcomes, not between people. We're not doing comparison between people. We're doing comparisons between strategies and outcomes. Yeah. That's what you're
just different choices. Everybody in the world as a human being is great, but you could make, you know, okay, I like that. I could totally be, I'm too nice. So yes.
Yeah. Everybody in the world as a human being is not great.
Yes. Okay. But, All right. I got it. Deal. You're right. You're earning your name. You know, okay. I love it. Okay. So what's the next one?
Okay. The last one. Last one is the edutainment switch. And the edutainment switch is, I am of the firm belief that no matter what setting you're in, no matter what industry you're in, if you can entertain people in any way, you have them. And I hear that a lot of times. People are like, oh, the world is an information overload. Oh, we have so much information. No one wants more information. And my question to these people is, if there is so much information and people are in information overload, what are they doing being stuck to their phones? What are they looking for in their phones? What they're looking for in their phones is entertainment, right? If you can position whatever you're teaching, whatever you're selling, even your speaking sales page, even your sales call, even your presentations, if you can position them in an entertaining way, it really works. And I know you're going to ask that question, so I'm going to answer it because I can see it in your eyes.
It's like, I don't even have to say anything. This is great.
Alien, you know, when you do the body snatching, you can see the alien tendrils coming out from the eyes. That's the question. I can see it coming out. You're like, how do we do in an in-person setting? So I am a Pakistani woman in Saudi Arabia. And that means that I have done presentations sometimes in offices where women are not allowed. And if I can go into those presentations and crack jokes, then honestly, anyone can do it. Because I remember when I had a pitch presentation and 2 hours before the meeting, we were told, oh, by the way, women cannot enter the building. And I was like, okay, so which surgery do I need to perform on myself to make that happen? And so, yeah, and if I can do it, honestly, you can still do it. You don't have to crack weird jokes, but you can still make it entertaining no matter what you're teaching.
Okay, this is what's so funny is I went to your website and everybody should go to your website anyway, definitely. But not only just to read the amazing content, because I got sucked in. You are such a great copywriter. I felt like I knew you as a human and because you're funny when I was reading the copy, which made me also a lot more relaxed on this side because I was like, oh, she's going to be great. We're going to get along well, right? Which is really important, like you're saying. So I couldn't stop reading, which is definitely important because I also love the other side of it where I'm like, damn, girl, you did a good job. So make sure everybody checks that out because I feel like people think that the teaching method has to be really boring when we're talking about website copy and stuff like that. And that is not true at all. And you've done an excellent job of that, which I appreciate.
Thank you.
It's rare.
we done with 8 switches. Oh God. Oh yes. Oh my God. Because I was like, what else am I going to forget? What is my husband's name again? Yeah. Okay.
That actually would be awesome and hilarious and entertaining. There you go. We're trying to hit every persuasion button when we go through this. So the reason why I wanted to talk about your business, because especially with your website, you have programs and that sort of stuff, but you only started a few years ago and you're crushing it and you don't have a team. So please, I would love sort of a little synopsis of because you already had experience in business. It's not like you weren't a consultant and stuff like that. But when we're looking at somebody getting into this, how have you had such a fast trajectory of success?
So two things. One, you said about the team. And I think one of the reasons that I grew so fast, I think it's probably because I didn't have a team. So I could, and that's, I know that sounds counterintuitive.
No, I love it. I get it. Okay, continue though so people get it.
Because I can think of a thing now and I can launch it by 2 a.m., right? If I had, and that means that I literally know in and out of my business. I know every single thing that has to happen from the website to plugins to updates to payments, every single thing. And now I do have someone who helps me out and she's absolutely fantastic, but I still respond to all of my emails on my own because I want to have that personal one-on-one connection with people. And I think that's really one of the main reasons I grew so fast was because I was extremely lean. The power and freedom that comes with dreaming a plan, dreaming a program, getting up in the morning and putting together the sales page and launching it. That freedom can only happen if you are extremely lean, right?
Oh, I know.
I wish I could say that about the physical aspect of it. I wish I was extremely lean. That could only happen if I was extremely lean. But
I wish I could outsource that. That'd be great. Yeah. But yeah. That's sort of the whole point. So it's funny. I don't think a lot of people that are sort of in the beginning stages, they're like, I want a team to do all the stuff I don't want. I literally spend hours planning out my scrum meeting for my hour and a half team meeting on Monday. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I could probably just do all this work in 3 hours instead of, you know, making sure everybody's got their pieces. And so yeah. You're right. So tell me how you, because the online, because I know I was still a geek and trying to go online, it's a totally different ball of wax. So how did you know what programs to launch and how to do that? Even if you're good at copy, which you are, how do we actually sell it? How'd you build? You built a big list. And if you could say how big it is, how did you do that?
So it's not a big list. But it's not big compared to the revenue that I have.
Seriously. So yeah.
That's the point I want to make. And since day one, I have been focused. List building was never my focus, simply because I did not understand the concept of list building. So I tried list building in the beginning. Everyone was like, oh, build a list. So I tried it and I was like, why am I gathering all these strangers on my list? Why am I paying for them? Because really, the day is like a penny dropped when I realized that I should be creating a list of buyers, not a list of subscribers.
Yes.
And when that happened, everything changed. So 20% of my list are buyers.
Wow.
And that really has changed everything for me. So even now, I would hesitate to just grow a list for the sake of growing a list. Because I don't want a list of freebie hunters. I don't want a list of people who just grab free stuff from me and treat me like a bloody library. I'm not a library. I'm a bookstore. Treat me like a bookstore. Spend money. It's a business, right? So that makes me sound so, so money hungry. I get it. I promise.
No, see, I think people need to hear this side of it because no offense, but online we are sold that just build a list and figure out what to sell them. And what I found over and over when people come to me, I'm like, your list is all over the place. You can't even find one thing to sell to 12% of it, let alone like the entire thing. So to me, it's not about just, to me, it's a vanity metric. Unless you can actually sell something to these people, unless it's a hobby, that's separate. If it's a hobby, that's totally fine.
Fan club, which is cool. I wish I had a fan club, but yeah.
I do like wonderful emails. I'm a words of affirmation kind of light lady. But what's so interesting, and if you can share some of the numbers, because your email list is 29,000, right?
Which is about 30 now, yeah.
In 2 years is ridiculous. Most people, the trajectory goes pretty slow. So what was the main way of finding not only the 29,000, but those 20% buyers? What tactics and stuff have been working really well for you?
So yeah, so the one thing that that's something that I wish I could just print. I would have to skip too many continents to come to the US to do that, but I wish I could kind of print billboards of this and share that with people. But I was just having a discussion with someone in my group about this idea, oh, that you should only be selling premium offerings. And I was telling them, I was like, the problem with, there is no problem. There are many ways to do a business. But the way I have done is that I basically sat and I mapped out what I like to call a bread to dream journey, right? So take your ideal buyer and map out her bread to dream journey. What's her bread situation and what's her dream situation? And then if you want to take her from the bread situation to the dream situation, what I did was I did not take her from bread to dream in one full swoop. Instead, what I did was that I created the first product, which was a 20% improvement product. So I created something that moved her 20% closer to her dream. So it's not because when you're just starting out and your first offer is a complete transformation offer, not only is it harder to create, it's also hard to sell. People don't freaking believe you, right? And you sometimes don't even believe yourself. But when you create a 20% offer, which only makes her miserable situation a little bit better, it's easier to create, it's easier to sell. So my first program was a 20% offer, which was a $47 product. I had a list of 1,300 people, and I sold 320 packages. Now, I was just asking this in my group. If I had a $2,000 product, how many do you think I would have sold? I would probably, if I were lucky, I would have probably sold two, right? But when I get those 320 people, now not only do I have 320 people who have opened their wallets and they've bought from me, and I can keep selling to them again and again and again and again, because marketing 101, repeat buyers are so much easier than new buyers, right? We know that. So that first step of getting those 320 buyers buying on the spot because the product was a 20% product, which means going back to the 8 persuasion switches, believability switch. She can believe me, she can believe the product, and she can believe in her own ability because it is believable, right? It's not, oh my God, that could never happen, right?
See? When I'm looking at your numbers, that's so incredible. Like, I work with a lot of people with smaller email lists, just a couple thousand. And to sell that much of a ratio and percentage of your list is incredible, even a low price product. And I love that you have a different name. I know Digital Marketer calls it a tripwire. And I feel like that's so horrible. Like, we're trying to kill everybody, right? Like, oh, let's go. But yours is like 20% improvement. I'm like, to me, that's so much better. How the heck did you sell 320 out of 1,300, number one, they're the right people is what it sounds like. But did you do like a crazy launch? How many emails? We already know you're a great copywriter.
Yeah, no, I collaborated with someone and we both combined on this. So it wasn't just my list. I collaborated with her. Her list was the same size. And together we sold 320. But that's the interesting part about that. And so many people don't believe this. And that is exactly why I have a screenshot of this conversation. So when someone says, I don't believe you, I can shove that in their face. So
I love you already. Okay.
So there is this amazing, amazing copywriter. Her name is Laura. I'm a huge fan of hers. And we were both in the same Facebook group. So I posted my sales page link in the group. That was about 2 years ago when I just started. I was like, you know, my first sales page, I don't even know how to write copy. I've never written copy. I don't even know whether copyright is R-I-G-H-T or W-R-I-T-E. I'm that illiterate when it comes to copy. So what do you guys think? And she said to me, I went to that sales page. I don't know you. I've never heard of you. I only saw the sales page and I bought on the spot because it was such a great offer. It was not my copy. It was my offer. And I say that over and over again. If your offer is great, a great offer trumps everything. It trumps great design, trumps great copy, trumps everything. Not the Trump, you know, not the Trump, but Trump. So I think it all boils down to a great offer. And I still remember what she said. I'm like, it's unbelievable. I never do impulse buy, but I just bought on the spot.
How did you get that great of an offer when it was your first offer ever? I mean, I know you know the persuasion tactics. Is that it or was there more?
I think it was that 20% improvement. So I knew exactly what their bread was. And then I created something that was and it's not just me. So a lot of my clients have done exactly that. One of my clients, she created her 20% product and she just put it up on her website, right? She did not email it to anyone, no one. Someone came to her website, stumbled on that sales page by mistake and bought it on the spot. And she was like, how does that even happen? No pitch, no ads, nothing. But, and I think that's where, and it's not just, again, when you do your 20%, then your next step is obviously to create your 40%, and then you create your 60%, and then you create your total transformation. So I like to call this launch stacking. You stack your launches in a way that you end up with a portfolio of products. And really, that portfolio of products has given me what, you know, all the revenue that I have. And all great businesses do that. All great businesses have portfolios of products. Why do we only have one program or two programs? We should also create portfolios. So I think that portfolio of 20%, 40%, 60% and total transformation, that portfolio and that launch stacking has allowed me to grow so quickly.
Okay. So I adore this also considering, so a lot of people read Digital Marketer and they talk about funnels and blah, blah, blah. They're trying to like make it super sexy. You're like, it's a portfolio of products, people. This is not like, I just know that people come to me and they're like, oh, I need a funnel. And I'm like, no, you need a business that has things that sell. You know what I mean? Yes. So, and way back when I get sales funnels and all that fun stuff, my mentor taught me years and years ago when it wasn't the cool thing on digital marketing, which I love Digital Marketer and I love what they teach in general because it's genius. But the way that you're framing it is really important. So can you just go through what your products look like, just names and price points, so we can sort of get an idea of what a 20% thing is, what a 40% thing is, all the way up? Because you have a 7 figures in revenue in 2 years, which is insane. So please enlighten us.
So the first product was 20% improvement. It was called 3-Day 3K. It was a program that was all about creating a landing page that gets you 3,000 subscribers in 3 days. It was called 3-Day 3K. I think the name was really punchy too. So I think that's
hilarious. I have 7 days to 1K. Man, I should have done 3 days to 3K. No, I'm kidding. But 3,000 person email list is really impressive. Okay.
So 3-Day 3K was the first product. It was a $47 product. The second product was what I called Persuasion Quickies, which was also a $49 product. It was also a 20% improvement product. Okay. But the first one was landing pages. This one was sales pages, about pages, and emails. The third product was a membership program, which was, I started at $7 per month, and then I went up to $14 and $19. Now it's $29 product. And it's a 40% improvement product because it has bits and pieces. It has hacks to quickly put together one thing. It has email scripts, what I like to call tricky conversation. You know, if you want to have a tricky conversation, if you want to hire someone, fire someone, approach someone for interviews, whatever. So it has all these scripts. It's a membership site. Now it's 29, but it used to be 7 and then 14 and 19. That was March 2015. Then in June 2015, I launched my 60% improvement product, which was called Email Persuasion Sequence. It was $299. And I sold about 200 of those. And again, you know, because of this progression, I've always sold in hundreds because I've kind of taken them through that journey. Then in October of 2015, I launched something called Mass Persuasion Method, which at that point, and that's really interesting, you know, when you create those portfolio of products, sometimes some of your products will cannibalize your other products, right? Mm-hmm. So when I launched Mass Persuasion Method, I had to kill the quickies because there was the risk of them cannibalizing my higher end product,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, okay, makes sense.
That's again, that's business 101, but I chose to kill them even though they made me 5,000 clean passive income. I had a funnel at that time. I don't have a funnel anymore. So October 2015, I came up with Mass Persuasion Method. It was a $4.99. It had three levels, $4.99, $7.99, and $14.99. So see, I'm growing. I started with $47 and kind of I'm progressing. Then in January 2016 was the first time where I offered one-on-one work with me. It was a $5,000 coaching package with one-on-one working with people. That was January 2016. It was $5,000. I opened up 5 spots. I ended up selling 10. But yeah, and considering I don't like human beings, that was kind of a little bit of a, but it was fun. I try to like human beings. I like you.
Like human beings. That's hilarious. I'm like, people, let me talk to more people, please. Yeah, you're hilarious. That's awesome.
When you said you talked to 5 people yesterday, a part of me died a little bit. If I talked to 5 people in a day, I'd probably crawl in a cave and never come out.
That's hilarious because 5 is low for me. We are very different, but I love that. Okay, so then what was the next one after that?
So next one, March was I relaunched, March 2016, I relaunched EPS, Email Persuasion Sequence 2.0, launched it again, sold about, last time I launched it, it was $297. This time I launched it, it was $499. I sold 200 of those again. June 2016, last year, was really my first high-end program. It was called Sold Out Launch, and that gave me about $700,000 in revenue, that one product. But if I had come out with that product 2 years ago, yep, it would have flopped. So, but now I've taken people through a journey, right?
Yeah, and of course they trust you because they're like, oh, we started with sales pages, yeah, and email lists and that sort of stuff. So give us your secret sauce on the email stuff too, because that's the other thing. The only reason why you can push products like this is because, well, number one, you're really good at sales, right? But that's why you teach this stuff. But number two is your email list was getting bigger of the right people. So what one or two or three tips can you give people to grow? Is it JVs or is it what, how can we get 3,000 people on our email list in 3 days?
So no, first of all, no JVs. All of this, probably in total, probably 5 affiliate members literally like 2 or 3 sales, maximum 5 sales from them.
Okay.
But one thing that I did, most people don't do, and I think that really helped me with that, again, list of buyers, was that the first 100 people who bought from me, I offered them to become my affiliates. And I'll share with you, this is something really interesting. I'll share with you why I did that. Because when we try to promote something, we look at people who are affiliate promoters, right? Who promote affiliate offers. But the problem is that those people promote just anyone. But even if someone does not have a following, does not have an email list, if she truly believes in your product and she got great results from your product, she is going to go and talk about your product. Why not give her the incentives? So that's what I did for about 3-4 months, where I offered the people who bought from me the offer to become an affiliate. I don't do that anymore because tech is a nightmare and I don't know how to handle that. But so I think one of the things that really grew my business so fast. The list in the beginning for the first 6 months of my business, I didn't do any paid advertising at all. So most of that was guest posting, a lot of guest posting. I guest posted for, I remember, I still was still working in consulting and I wrote 8 guest posts in one weekend. Some of those, one of those guest posts actually got me my first paying client as well. So, so that was, you know, that was, I think that was really, guest posting was really, really, really great for me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Quick question on guest posting, because I feel like people don't really talk about the stats behind it. On average, how many email signups did you get per, and I know it depends on how big the guest post is, but if you have an idea on like how big the guest post is versus how many email signups you got, what were we looking at?
So I'm going to tell you about, okay, most of my guest posts bombed. But the one that took off, that got me, I think that got, so far, it was published in probably the first month that I started my business. So let's just say about 2.5 years ago. In the last 2.5 years ago, in the last 2.5 years, it has at least gotten me, if I'm not wrong, at least 3,000 people. And not just that, it has also gotten me, made me at least 10,000, I would say.
That happened to me too. Because when I was, when I first started, I did a ton of guest posts. Most of them also bombed. One of them got me press on like everything. And right as soon as the article came out, it was like 500 email subscribers. I was like, this is amazing. Guest post everywhere. And then a whole bunch did, you know, bombed again too. Okay. Yeah. So now you do paid advertising. I know we have to start wrapping up, unfortunately, because I have another one right after this. But so now you do paid advertising. In a nutshell, give me what that looks like.
So what I like to do is I take a very different approach, and you talk about digital marketing. I think they'll probably just kill me for saying this, but the way I do ads is I like to, again, take a more psychological approach to it. So I run ads throughout the year, but I don't run ads to grow my list. What I do run ads for is to become a familiar face in the people's newsfeed. That's what I do. And I like to call those seduction ads. And the idea behind those seduction ads is all I'm doing is, so I just did a parody video, no opt-in, no call to action, nothing. It's just a parody video of me. My name is Lucy Diamond McDreamy, and I'm pretending to be a nine-figure entrepreneur, and I'm giving this really lame webinar on webinars. And I'm running this, and it has about, I think, 10,000 views in like probably 2-3 days. And all it is doing is making me a familiar face in people's newsfeed. So now when I come out with an actual ad, when I'm getting up for a launch and I come out with an opt-in ad, people are far more likely to sign up because they've seen me, right? So again, mere exposure effect, psychological effect. When we see something, when something is familiar, we like it more. Familiarity breeds likability. So I'm all about being familiar in newsfeed. And that gives me conversions for, I've had Facebook ad conversions for 20, 30 cents a conversion because I use this strategy. If I just ran cold traffic to my opt-in ads, my ads would probably bomb too. But seduction ads really help me, you know, become a familiar face.
I love that you name it too. And it's entertaining. So that's amazing. It's funny. That's what one of my Facebook ad friends just told me the other day, to really level that side of things up, because it was mostly we were going after the digital marketing strategy and this is what we do. And even digital marketer has been changing what they're saying as far as warming people up beforehand, especially with video. So I know we have to start wrapping up because like the other person already messaged me right now. I would talk to you all day long and I can't, but that's okay. So I'm going to ask the last question. What's one thing listeners can do this week to help move them forward towards their goal of a million?
Oh, I love this question. This is my favorite question. I will try to save you on time and not drag on and on about this. But I think I am the least woo-woo person that you will ever meet, but I want to show you this. So this is something that I made for myself, and I'm not woo-woo at all, but I made myself this, and I dated
that.
It for December 31st, 2016, and it says $1 million. And I'm not woo-woo, but I saw Jim Carrey do it, or I don't know, Will Smith, one of those people. And that really helped me. And when I put it up in here, there is a picture of a hot girl next to it. And my husband came in and he was like, you know what? This is totally happening. That, not really sure. And he's right. Bloody.
My mind believes I can make money instead of being, lean. Yeah, no, I get it.
Not woo-woo, even though I'm absolutely not woo-woo. I that really helped me. And I think also when you, we're all about goal setting, but when I set my goals, I don't set one goal. I always set three goals. So there is one, which is an extreme bloody out of this world kind of goal, and then there is a regular goal, and then there is a bare minimum goal. And I like to kind of, you know, plan my launches or plan my promotions based on the, these three levels. And I think that really helps, because I think a lot of people are, even though $1 million are important and they're great and they change everything and life is great with money, the reality is money in and of itself is nothing, right? So when I look at this number, I don't know whether you know this, but 10% of my revenue goes to charity. So when I look at this number, I think to myself, oh my God, I just raised $100,000. So right now I have $112,000 that I can invest wherever I want. And that having something bigger than just the money, just the number itself, really helps. Because I keep getting, I was like, okay, I can build 25 schools. Now, that you can't, can you imagine the impact and the, it's life changing, right? So I think that really helps. That really helps keeping, thinking of something that's bigger than just a number.
See, you're not a bitch. No, I'm kidding. I love that. And I actually have not done that yet with the check thing. So I'm writing it on my little post-it note because it's silly that I haven't, but nobody's ever said that before. So thank you very much for the reminder. Everybody make sure they do that too. So where can we find more about you and get all your secret sauce stuff? I want to definitely link to that parody video too. So make sure you send me that link because I think that's hilarious and awesome. I want to see it. But where can we find and follow and all that fun stuff for you?
So thank you so much, first of all, Jaime, for having me. It was an absolute blast. I'm so, so grateful that we got to chat. My website is thepersuasionrevolution.com. I also have the Mass Persuasion Guide, the one that I talked about, and I would love to just send it to you without any opt-in. I would love for you to, for your people to have access to it. I honestly do not believe in creating a list. So I think that's pretty clear. So I'm just going to send a link to you as a gift. I would really appreciate if your people could have access to it. And that's it. I was such a pleasure having you. To talk to you.
You do a podcast too. What's your podcast so everybody can check it out?
It's called The Persuasion Show. And yeah, it's kind of dramatic, but yeah.
Yeah, it sounds awesome. So I'll have, I don't listen to any podcast, by the way, but maybe I'll start actually listening to yours. That sounds fantastic. And thank you so much for coming on. Like I said, I could talk forever. You're amazing. I hope you have an awesome day. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you enjoyed that interview. And if you want to check out more amazing resources, I'm only curating the best of the best. Go check out eventualmillionaire.com. You can take the Eventual Millionaire quiz, figure out where you are in business and what you need right now. Plus, you can look at curated resources specifically for you on the new Start Here page. I'm so excited. Please join us. Please let me know if you need anything at all. I'm here for you. And have a fantastic day. Bye.